Well, first off, I want to thank you guys that came in the morning. Being here early, being part of the day, you guys get a chance to see that. I'm glad that you get a little bit of an idea of how it works. This is our Super Bowl for signing, and a big day for the coaches, players, everybody involved. There's so many people that help in this process to get these guys here. It really is a special day, and for you guys to be able to share that with us, we appreciate it. We were here at 5 in the morning, Germany Brown, to get his NLI in, and it's different now. The fax machine, non-existent. So we had nobody around the fax machine today. It's all about taking pictures of it, sending it in, and much easier, much more convenient, and we're able to get the information without the stress of the fax machine and the paper and all those things going out. And you say fax machine to these guys, they have no idea what you're talking about. But a great morning, and for the coaches that put in all the time with these guys, I think back to Chase Cord. When Coach Hill had him on the phone this time last year, and we're having a conversation with him, talking about Boise State. Hey, this might be a right place for you. Could be a good fit. Let's get you here on campus. And all of a sudden, here he is, officially signing today. So it's a long process. You build a relationship with these guys, and our coaches do a tremendous job of doing it the right way. And there's really nothing to sell. From the Boise State standpoint, we're just sharing with these recruits who we are, what we're about, and we hope that we find the right guys that feel the same way. Darren Usher, you know, I want to say thank you to him, is our director of recruiting, and probably has the best relationship of all of us with all these guys, talks to them every day. Anything these guys need, he's on it. He's obviously constantly searching for players, and if we have somebody that we don't get or miss, he's on top of that. Chris Ross as well, right there alongside. And Chris Ross, when Junior Adams left, Chris Ross the next day was, or the next couple days, was literally on the road recruiting. And so he was up and running, ready to go. We had him in Texas, but now to keep building these relationships with these guys, he was ready and did a tremendous job. Taylor Tharp for organizing the weekends and making sure that these guys feel what it is to be a Bronco and to keep everything coordinated that way. So many other people I can't thank in the whole entire process, but it brings us all here today. We got 19 guys that we signed, 13 today. Riley Wimpy, who had already signed but is going to be a part of this class, is in there. We also had an exciting day too. We put Jake Knight on scholarship today, so that was something that is well deserved. He certainly earned, but was also a big part of today, and a moment for our football team. We're in here as an entire group, and excited for him to be a part of this class officially on scholarship. And so I think we met our needs, what we needed to get. I think we feel good about where we are right now. We have a couple that we're going to be able to use, and there's always going to be guys that are late guys that we're going to be able to find, and if they're the right fit for our program, we're going to be able to recruit them and bring them in. If not, it gives us options, which is always a good thing, and we've done that for a lot of years and found some really good players when all is said and done. But overall, the guys behind me and the names, each one of these guys, there's a different story. There's a purpose to why they're here. Each one of them has goals and dreams. Every one of their families were a part of this process. And we're just happy to be where we are right now with the group of guys that we have. And certainly excited about our future, where we're going, and this group of guys coming in. So. Exciting day. It's not over yet. We've been talking about these guys quite a bit. We're going to talk about them again right now. We're going to be out at Big Al's tonight, and we're going to celebrate with Bronco Nation and talk about these guys and brag on them, because that's what today is all about. And I tell the guys this all the time. On signing day, you get to do it one time. Take advantage of it. Some of these guys are so focused. They're waiting for the workout. They're waiting for the football part of it. And it's like, hold up. Take time to enjoy this moment. Because you have an opportunity now to come to a great place. You have an opportunity to get your school paid for. You get a chance to play major Division I college football, to live your dream, to be around great people, and for your family as well. And I think about that There were some really emotional meetings because these parents, when you sit in there and these guys have committed to you and they realize that they're going to be able to do things through the game of football and being a good student and being a good person, that is an advantage. What an awesome opportunity to realize that goal and dream. Now, when they come here, it's time to get to work. They understand that as well. But today's a special day, and we're proud to be a part of it. So with that, open up for questions.
I know you kind of have to wait, you know, 3, 4, maybe even 5 years to find out how good this recruiting class is. But how do you kind of come away from actual signing day and evaluate the progress you made in the class itself?
Well, I think the overall success rate is, did these guys stay and graduate? Because that, you know, again, football is never guaranteed. These guys have to come and they have to work. They got to prepare. They got to perform to actually go out there and play. Football can be taken away like that. So with the families, this is also about their education. And are we graduating these players? You know, are they on track to graduate? All right. Is this the place that they want to continue their education? Are they getting a chance to contribute as a player? They don't have, you know, we're not saying every one of them is a superstar. But do they do the things that we talked about in the meetings we had and the reason why they committed? That's really how you see success from those players. Not everybody does that. You know, very rarely, it doesn't ever happen that a class you sign, everybody stays and finishes. You hope that happens. But that's how I look at it. And do we have the type of relationships that we talked about that we've built over the course of time while they're here? And you know, now that we're going into this next year and this class, we've recruited the majority now, not every single one of the guys on this team, but they've been a part of this staff and what we're about. And I think we're seeing more of that. We're seeing the relationships, we're seeing things that we have been through in the recruiting process to where they are now. Some of these guys as sophomores and juniors, and it's going to pay off, you know, because that culture now with these guys coming in, they're going to be the ones that are learning from the guys we have here now. And so I've been proud of our guys. Guys have worked hard. We graduated our players. They played well. And I think you look at it like that. You know, how many championships you win, they'll pay attention to those things. They certainly want to do that. I look at the big picture and go, are we making a difference in these kids' lives? Are we preparing them for life after football? Because all they've ever done is football and school. Football and school, that's all they've ever done. If they get a chance to go on and play, the school part's out of it. They'll play in the NFL. But are these guys leaving here prepared for that moment when football and school is done and they're ready to get out in the real world? So, you know, that's how I look at it.
You mentioned meeting your needs or filling your needs. What did you see as the biggest needs in this class?
And yeah,
I know it's obvious with the positions, I guess we can tell, but what characteristics or things did you want from guys in this class?
Yeah, well, quarterback, you know, we had that, and obviously that changed when Tommy Stewart decided that he was going to pursue somewhere to play. You know, this is the thing, when I look at coaches, they always have an answer. You have to be prepared for so many things because you deal with people, and that's okay. They're not products, they're people. And some guys, they make decisions based off whatever they're thinking at that time, and do you have an answer for it? Well, we did. And, you know, Raythan Reisdorf comes in here, and we like him. He's been a great addition, and he's going to get a chance to go out there and compete. And that's the one thing about this quarterback class. Neither one of them were like, well, you know, you have a guy there and all that. They're just like, do I get an opportunity to compete? Yes. All right, I'm good. That's all guys want to know, the true competitors. Wide receiver was a big need on offense. Running back was not, and then McNichols decides that he wants to, you know, pursue the NFL. Well, that changed our numbers, but we still were going to take one. We talked about taking two, but felt like one was going to be the best for us this year, and we'll look at taking two in the next class. But wide receiver was a need. I wanted to sign three. You know, we're talking about taking two, but we felt like three was going to be the best option for us to keep building that room and create competition in there. So that was obviously big. And then the O-line, we have a lot of good young O-linemen, but we still needed to fill some needs and numbers. And, you know, you get a guy like John Ojukwu that comes in here, he enrolls early, and here's a guy that getting our hands on him right now Fantastic student, but this is only going to make him better as a player. Isaiah Moore battled for him, and all of a sudden, you know, he's coming to Boise State, and here's a guy that's going to come in here and compete right away to play. So we have a guy now that, and Zach Trouton, who's here, these two guys are competing to play right away. Two junior college players. That leaves us with an opportunity to maybe take another O lineman if needed, or we bump that number forward because we do like the young ones that we got. And we got a lot of guys coming back. On the defensive side, D-line, Sonatane Louie, we put him on scholarship, so we did not have a need for an inside interior D-lineman. We needed to take a stud. Isa Clemente was the guy. And his story, back and forth a little bit, all said and done. Coach Caldwell, Coach Avalos, those guys did a tremendous job of continuing that relationship. And, you know, sometimes it's just a matter of, you know, what really matters when it's all said and done. And I think Isa saw that and his family. And we had a great relationship. And he could see when he came back on his visit, this is for me. This is where I need to be. Linebacker on the defensive side, that was really a position of need. You know, we're talking about taking four. Riley Wimpy's coming back. Now you start to get in that cycle again. If you take four, you're going to lose four eventually. You're going to be back into that cycle. And so I think where we are right now with Roman, with Zeke in there, Braden Boyd, those guys, I think that gives us good depth. It allows us to maybe find another one. We could now potentially, or hey, we have good depth at that position, and we'll catch up in the next recruiting cycle. And so that was obviously a big one for us, but I feel good about the guys we have now. They're ready to play. Zeke will not be when he comes in. He's got an ACL, a lot like Tyson, but he's behind where Tyson was, so he won't be probably ready to play when it's all said and done, which is okay. He's too good of a player, too good of a person, has a tremendous family. We were okay with that. We want to help him rehab. And then DB, you know, we had a couple safeties, but really a corner. And I think the need, you know, you asked this earlier, but I think if you look at our guys, they're kind of two-way players. They've got good ball skills, and you know, that was something that we looked at, not necessarily because of the way the season went, that we have to have guys going out there just to intercept passes and all that, but we're just getting better football players, the guys that play football at more positions was one of the things. And you know, we kind of looked at it like that, like this guy's a returner, he plays on offense, he plays on defense. I liked that when I was watching the film the coaches were bringing. I'm like, this guy's kind of all over the field and doesn't come off. You like that. And I think that was something that just kind of caught on because I'd made a few comments about it. I think all the coaches were on the same page, like we're just getting guys that are just playing football more and maybe better football players overall. It's kind of how we looked at this class.
People kind of discount stars next to a player's name in the scouting services. You do have a four-star guy in Germani Brown.
Yeah.
How do you look at that four-star and keeping all those expectations in check?
Yeah. You know, I've said this, and I think every coach will say that. I don't even know who gives it to him. You know, I know we were recruiting one guy, and he was a three-star, and then somewhere magically I had seen that somebody had given him the fourth one. I don't know who gave it to him, but he was promoting it, and which is okay. That's all part of kind of the fun in recruiting. You know, there is fun in that, but that really has nothing to do with – I don't even know what stars they are when the coaches bring them in. That's never a question that I ever ask. It's a matter of, all right, tell me what his core GPA is. Tell me what his test score is. Let's pop on the film. Why do you like him? Does he fit the position ideals? And we have position ideals, height, weight, size, you know, comparisons to guys we've had in the past. Like, what type of guy is this? You know, Kekala. You know, hey, he's a lot like Jeremy Iwani. You know, obviously there's that connection from Hawaii there too, but the way he plays, very instinctive, size-wise, and a guy that just goes out there and makes plays. So, you know, the star standpoint, I think that's more of, I don't know who gives them out. It's just part of it. And I know people pay a lot of attention to that, but pay more attention to the production this guy has. Pay attention to how he does academically. And those are the things we look at, and then we get to know him. You know, is he willing to come in here and work? And I think we're very honest about that. It's really hard. You're going to have to work harder than you've ever worked. You know, is this really what you want to do? And does he love football? If he loves football, then we found that guys that around here, they do pretty well.
What was it about John Ojukwu that caught your eye? And I mean, talking with him, he said he gained like 100 pounds in a year yeah. by drinking just a bunch of milk and stuff. But,
yeah.
And then on top of that, too, how do you evaluate the guys that you let in and want to come in early?
Yeah.
I mean, if they can graduate, is the door open or is there more of an evaluation there?
Yeah. Well, John was a guy we had in camp. We had known about him. He did put on about 80 pounds. He put on quite a bit of weight in a short amount of time. And if you see his frame, he's still light for how tall he is. We looked more at him as, here's a guy that has no idea the potential that he has to be a successful football player. And getting around him, being around him, just his drive, motivation to want that. I think he doesn't know what we see necessarily. He just knows that he wants to be great at something. Great student. He's been in here. He's worked really hard, and we've been fired up. He's been one of the guys that right out of the gate, you're going, that guy's got a chance just by the way he works. And as far as guys coming in early, these guys have to plan this out. And then when they have that plan, they're on track, I look at it, and I always ask them, are you sure you want to do this? Is this really what you want to do, is skip your senior year, all right, the second semester, and we're going to allow you to go back for prom, we're going to allow you to go back for graduation. They're going to do all those things. If they don't, all right, that's going to be a problem, because they need to do that. It's important for them. It's important for their classmates to see them back there and to be a part of it. Some guys just have in their minds that, hey, we're all selfish as coaches. We want them here. So we'll take him as long as we have a spot, which we always do. This doesn't happen that often. But in John's case, you know, right down the road, hey, I want to be there early. Well, here's a guy that once we can coach him and get our hands on him a little bit sooner, get him established weight-wise of being on track to keep gaining weight and getting bigger, it's probably going to be a better thing for him. He saw that, his mom saw it, his coach saw it, and we felt like that was a great fit. Marcus was just ready. Marcus is ready to get out of high school. He's ready to move on. He wants to get to college, and that's been a goal of his for a long time. And, you know, we look at that and go, this guy's mature enough to be here. The difference when these guys come in spring is they're coming into a team that's established. Everybody knows when you're supposed to go left. All right. When they come in the fall, everybody doesn't know that. They're with 20-some other guys that are probably doing it wrong for the first few days. So, you know, when these guys come in, it's eye-opening. Everybody's doing this. Everybody knows how to do it. Everybody knows what to expect, and they don't. And, you know, it takes a little bit of an adjustment for them. But our guys understand that. They do a good job. They keep them motivated. And that's the biggest thing I look at, is just, you know, probably more from a mental standpoint, is this guy going to be ready to handle it? And the guys that have come in here have.
Some coaches look at recruiting as like a necessary evil, and some really enjoy it. And you seem to be someone who really enjoys the recruiting process. And what about it do you enjoy the most? And what particular skills do you believe you and your staff have that make you so successful at it?
Yeah, well, I like it from the standpoint, you know, it's all about recruiting. It's all about getting to know the guys you're bringing in. And I like the relationship part of it. I like to hear the goals and dreams that these guys have, and do they fit within what we're trying to accomplish. You know, it's time consuming. You know, you're talking to 17-year-old kids and having those conversations, you know, and they change their mind, and things are different every single day. It's when you find the right ones. You know, it does wear on you a little bit when you have too many of the wrong ones you're recruiting, but when you find the right one, then everything changes. And when you're in that home and you have them on campus, when you bring them here and they sign and you get to know, okay, I've got this young person coming into our program that over the next 4 or 5 years, we can change their life. We can truly make a difference. And to me, I think that's pretty rewarding. I mean, what other profession can you do that where you can take a young person and by the time he leaves, you've made a huge impact? They're all thinking about where they're going. They're all thinking about what school they're going to. We're thinking about where they're going to come from when it's all said and done. You know, when people ask them, why are you successful? You know, why are you doing the things you're doing? Well, I came from Boise State. So we think of it more like that. And to me, that's pretty powerful when you actually sit back and go, you know, in the profession you have, you can make that type of impact on people's lives. That's what's rewarding about it. And it's scary too, because sometimes it doesn't always work. So it's scary when that doesn't happen. You start to think about some of the negatives when it doesn't work out. And, you know, I think that is why you're so tedious in your recruiting process, and why sometimes we just want to make sure it's exactly right. As far as the staff goes, I think it's easy. We're not really selling anything. I think we're just talking about our program. And when the guys come in here, hey, this is who we are. This is what we believe. This is what we're about. We tell the guys all the time that college football is really hard. If you're going to play at Boise State, it takes a lot of work. Here's the things you can do. Here's things as being a major Division I college football player that you can't do. Here's the benefits. Here's the disadvantages. And we try to just be honest with them. And if that doesn't fit for them, it's okay. You know, we're okay with the fact that if we sign a guy, we're going to have him for about 48 games. If we don't sign a guy and play against him, we only see him four times. So, you know, be smart about the ones we bring in here, and just know that that's a major part of this program, because that can destroy your program too. You get too many of the wrong ones that don't fit what you're about. That can also be a bad thing for your culture in this program. And Boise State's had it for a long time. We didn't design it. The culture's been here for a long time. Our job is to keep enhancing it, to uphold the standard of what the culture is, and make sure we find guys that are going to come in here and do the things the Bronco way. And it's all said and done.
The last signing you guys had was Kaniho, and I know we haven't had a chance to ask you much about him, but you know, how did he kind of pop up on your radar? And it seems like he's a guy who, you know, can hit, but also you saw he had so many touchdown returns that was kind of unique too.
Yeah, he's got a knack now. He's probably the comparison for some of us former Broncos that are on the staff here is Marty Tadman. You know, I said Jeremy Iwani. The other part of it too, just his savvy is Marty Tadman. Marty Tadman was that way. Kala is, you know, he's going to come here and put on weight, but Gabe went and saw him. They played Gorman, and he was at that game. I mean, this was in Vegas. They had a huge fan base from Hawaii that was there. I mean, this is one of the biggest games. I saw a video he had of it. It's kind of sent it to the staff. And he went and watched, obviously, a lot of players that were really good in that game. But Kala was a guy that stood out, that we were on, and didn't shy away from the competition. They didn't win that game, but here's a guy that was competing and trying to get his team to compete, and he's on a really good football team in Hawaii, and it really stood out. And all of a sudden, we're having conversations, and he's all about family, fantastic student. You know, wants to be a part of the engineering program, biomechanical engineering, and build prosthetics. You know, he's into that. And it was all about really the fit when it's all said and done. So to me, when I started to talk to him on the phone, you get a relationship, you FaceTime and do all that. You can only do so much. When he comes up here on the visit and you all of a sudden see him and you get face to face, all right, you're sold. You know, here's a guy he's a little bit undersized, and you know, he's going to put some weight on and all that. But as far as pure football players, and we talk about that, this guy can do it, and all the other things on top of it with his family and being all in. I mean, it's a no-brainer. And that relationship, too, with players from Hawaii. We've recruited that area, and we've done a pretty good job, you know, in the past. And, you know, I think we got another good one from there.
I know you had the USC offer last night, and you had one safety, or I guess DB, that you lost today maybe, but overall, in terms of drama and things like that, I mean, there's been years where you've had four or five actual announcements you're waiting on and things like that. I mean, overall, was this kind of a maybe drama-free, more relaxed year than usual? Or
I wouldn't say that. Yeah, it's still, there was probably more drama than we all know about right now, but certainly, you know, with ISA and in that situation there, you just don't know. We've been there before, and these late offers that come in, you know, and did we really lose anybody? Yeah, we didn't sign who we anticipated, but really towards the end, we had a pretty good idea we wouldn't. And that's okay. You know, when it's all said and done, like I said before, I mean, we want to make sure, don't sign. We tell them all the time, don't do this if it's not the right fit. Well, it wasn't the right fit. And that's okay. And now, you know, those players go on to other places, excited for them. They get a chance to live their dreams, and we get a chance to bring in the right guy. That's going to fit this culture and what we're all about. So I thought the coaches, you know, there was a few messages last night. We all thought we were going to get into bed a little bit early. And, you know, we have a staff text and things were getting fired out. And finish was a big part of it. So we had a lot of phone calls last minute, a lot of text messages, and just making sure, you know, when it was all said and done. And not everything went our way from that standpoint, but it all works out like it's supposed to. And it's good to see, too, when guys do get those last minute offers, and there's some, you know, pretty powerful schools that come in and do that, that those guys are like, I'm good. You know, this is where I want to be. And that's reassuring, too, that your process and how you're doing things and relationships are there.
I know that you're going to take some time off. Class of 2017 is done, but what is the biggest thing that needs to be emphasized on the class of 2018, and when do we start hitting that with coaches?
Yeah, we already have. Yeah, we've already had guys offered. We're making phone calls today. And again, you go back and you think about Chase Corbin and that conversation, and on this day, and several of these guys that we had these conversations with. So we're already on that. I mean, you're always in the business you're in and the business you're becoming, right? So we're already thinking about 2018. We're already on to that class. We're already talking to guys, building those relationships, inviting those guys to come up here unofficially, come see us, come visit us, come to junior days, come here in the summertime to camps. You know, we're already on that. Need-wise, you know, we'll go back through those numbers. We're in a much better place, in the best place we've ever been as of right now, all right, going into the 18 season. You know, we're not where we need four guys at a position. We're not where we have 60 linemen that are needed. You know, we're more at kind of two and one and maybe none. And so it takes time to build your squad back up when you lose guys. You know, and that happened early on. You know, when we got here, there were some, and obviously over time. So now, you know, retention and attrition, you know, hopefully that doesn't affect you, but you're starting to build your squad to get back on track. And, you know, now we're not going to be in that 25 initial category where we can't go over and we have more scholarships to offer. You know, we're going to be more in that 14, 15 range. And now, you know, if something changes, we're going to be able to sign 20 again and not worry about the 25 number when it's all said and done. But we hope we're not there. We hope we're still in that 15-16 range, which is ideal, and with the option of picking some guys up maybe later when things change. So we're on it right now. To answer your question, we're on it. Yeah, it never ends. I mean, it is recruit, teach, connect with your – I mean, it's those three things is what it's all about. And so recruit, you want it, recruit it, you know, and you got to keep doing that every day. And then we'll go back with our players when we get back and recruit those guys again and build those relationships and start establishing ourselves for next season, teaching them how we were going to do things, and then connecting with everybody on this squad and bringing it all together before we get into fall camp and ready to roll for the season.